deception. Dagon now is the closest man to God. The thing that I love about David, Godfrey, is that David is the kind of individual that he has now an open and an honest conversation with his God. Because he understands that that God is not some foreigner. He's not some image or personality that sits way up in heaven on a throne and manipulates us. He understands he's my Father. He's my God. And David now in prayer, watch this, does not handle God as if he's insecure. Because God is not intimidated, nor is he insecure. The fact of the matter is, when you pray, you can't offend God. Because he's not intimidated. Tell your neighbor, he knows who he is. You got to know how to go to him and not ask some strange figment of your imagination. He's your Father.
Yeah.
That's why when we go to him, we call him Abba. Yes. Intimate Abba Father. And so the challenge comes in fellowship that we can never get stuck. Yes, Lord, I hear you. We can never get stuck on the how and the why and never focus or target in on the what. Because many of us get stuck on how God's going to do it. And even why he allowed me to go through what I necessarily went through. But those particulars are not important. Because I can tell you what God's done for me. Even if I can't explain why he did it. You got to be able to communicate and to understand what God has done and stop trying to figure out how he did it. Because the truth of the matter is, I could care less how he did it and why he did it. I'm just glad he did it.
Yeah.
Touch your neighbor, tell him I'm glad he did it. And you, ladies and gentlemen, as we walk with the Lord, we have to be able, sometimes, pastors, hear me, we have to be able to live without some answers, because God is not going to give us all of the answers. You have to be satisfied with him. Even if he don't give you the answer.
Yeah.
Because he becomes the answer. Even while you're still searching out an answer. We've got this thing mixed up, ladies and gentlemen. I've been walking with God now for 40 some years. And one of the things that I discovered in the last several years of my relationship with the Lord that I did not understand during the beginning stages, I thought that the closer you get to God, the more answers you receive. But the longer I walk with God, I discover that the closer you get to God, the more questions you have. Oh, is there anybody in here? I'm talking about, you've been with the Lord for years now, and it seems like every time you get to another dimension, you get more questions about who he is. But that's what causes us to lean on him. That's what causes us to depend on him. That's what causes us to trust him. And what the Lord is saying today, life center, hear me. God is saying, I can't give you all of the answers, because the more you have, the less you depend on me. You already think you're wonderful. You already think you're self-reliant. You already are arrogant and puffed up. You already have an issue with your ego. And you don't even know anything about me. But what keeps you tied into him and dependent on him is that I got to hold back some stuff.
Yeah.
Until you love me, even without the answer. We're control freaks. Yes, we all look at you every time. You're a control freak. You want to know everything. You want to know how it's going to get done, when it's going to get done, and how it's going to be accomplished. But the fact of the matter is, when you walk with God, you've got to have faith in God. When everything else around you looks inconsistent. I'm looking at Job.
Yes, sir, Bishop.
Job is a perfect man.
That's what the Bible says. Yes, sir.
He eschews evil.
Uh-huh.
That means he stays away from drama.
Yeah.
He walks upright with God. And the Bible says, watch this, he is a worshiper.
Yeah.
Yes.
Even after he loses everything, he still has worship. You want to know the barometer that always should be used whether you are mature in God? Because that's what that word perfect means. It doesn't mean you got all your spiritual eyes and cross all your spiritual T's. That word means that you're perfect. That there is a level that you're mature. There's a level of maturity in God. Not perfect, but I'm mature. The way that you can use, the thing that you can use as a barometer, whether you are mature in God, is the level of worship that you maintain when you start losing stuff. Oh, come on, come on. Anybody can praise God while you got money in your pocket, promotion on your job, car to drive every time you walk out in the driveway. But the thing that will determine whether you are mature in God is if you lose everything.
Oh, God.
And you can still praise God. In fact, look at your neighbor and tell him, I've been with God long enough that if I lose everything and all I had was Jesus, I still have enough to start all over again. I can praise him broke.
Yeah.
I can praise him sick.
Yeah.
I can praise him all by myself. Because it's not about what he does for me. If it just shows up. Chapters.
Preach.
37 chapters.
Yeah.
Job hears nothing from God.
Mm-hmm.
37 chapters. And it seems like the heavens are shut up like brass. He hasn't sinned. He hasn't disrespected God.
Mm-hmm.
But 37 chapters in Job, God is silent.
Yeah.
Somebody showed up this week and you found yourself in the middle of 37 chapters.
My.
Lord.
It was necessary for you to be here this week because you needed to hear a word from the Lord.
Yeah.
37 chapters. Job hears nothing from the God he worships. And he continues to say things like this. He knows the way that I take.
Yeah.
And when he has tried me, I'm coming forth as pure gold. He continues to say things like this. Man is born of a woman. It's but a few days, and those few days are full of trouble. He continues to say things like this. The 37 chapters were met. God ain't speaking. Ain't no goosebumps. Ain't no hair standing up on the back of his neck. Ain't no hikararabasikandrevesia. Ain't no falling out. But he continues to say things like this. He said, the Lord give it. What do you do when God gets silent on you? Is anybody here? Has God ever got quiet on you? I mean, you pray, but he ain't talked back. It seemed like your prayers hit the roof and ricocheted back. What do you do when it looks like God has gotten silent on you? Well, you do what Job did. Chapters, God is quiet. 37 chapters, God is silent. But John said, you may be silent, but I'm gonna keep talking.
Yeah.
You got to be able to keep talking. Even when God is silent, you ain't saying nothing, Lord, but I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And his praises shall continually be. I'll tell your neighbor, when he stops talking, you keep talking.
He stops talking, you keep talking.
Keep talking. Yeah.
Here's what it says, and I'm done. Look what the psalmist says. Keep calling me.
Yeah.
And you keep insulting me.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, you're playing games with my head.
My.
Because at least if I knew the root.
Yeah.
Or the reason.
Mm-hmm.
Why you're quiet about it. One of the challenges of pastors is that in those seasons when God gets quiet, it is still our responsibility to give a word to the people. That's the quandary of being a pastor. That there are times when God's silence becomes louder than his voice. And yet we are still responsible to stand before the people and declare what thus saith the Lord. How do you handle the silence of God?
Mm-hmm.
Right there in that next verse. The psalmist says, every day I'm calling on you.
My.
Every day.
Every day.
Not just Sunday, every day.
Yes, sir.
I'm calling on you.
Yeah.
And you do not respond with an answer. Every night I'm lifting my voice. And it seems as though you've got an attitude with me. But look at verse 3 is the answer. He says, but thou art holy. How do you handle the silence of God? You got to learn how to say to him, but thou. Because the word holy in the Hebrew is the word kadesh. And the word kadesh
see that God is still holy. I need you to throw your hands up and say, Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
You're different than I am. And sometimes I can't figure you out. Sometimes I can't put my finger on you. But I'll still praise you because you're God and you're God alone. Here it is. We're going to ordain these elders. He says here, he says, you are holy.
Yes.
You're different than I am. You're not obligated to answer.
That's right. That's right.
Because it is a fact. My sons and daughters, it is a fact that God is always speaking.
Uh-huh.
But it is also a fact that he ain't always speaking to you.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you hear what I said?
Yes, sir.
I have to be settled in his holiness.
Yeah.
To know, like Job said,
he knows. Yes, sir.
And sometimes I gotta trust him even when I can't hear his word. Elder Lisa Goodwin, Elder Lisa Goodwin called me about a month ago. Leah Levy called me about a month ago, month and a half ago. And she asked me a question. She said, Bishop, I gotta preach in a few days. She said, now I'm in a quandary. I got a problem. I said, Lee, what's your problem? She said, I've been studying, I've been praying, and I've been seeking to hear from God. She said, but as much as I study, and as much as I pray, I just can't hear a word from the Lord. She said, I got a couple more days. What do I do when God gets silent on me? Even in the midst of his expectation for me to fulfill the assignment.
That's
I said, Lily, I know how you feel. Because there have been Sundays I laid awake all night Saturday. And I could not hear nothing from the God that I serve. She said, well, Dad, what did you do? I said, preach what he said last time.
Yeah.
Stop trying to impress the people. And sometimes you got to have a Deuteronomy message. Say it again until they get it. Tell your neighbor, say it again. Say it again. Say it again. What do you do when God gets silent on you? You got to say like David, you're holy. The miracle of the text. Thank you for your audience. The miracle of the text is that the psalmist uses very interesting lingo because he begins to talk. He says, always keep a button near close. Tell your neighbor, always keep a button nearby. Always have a button nearby. Because that conjunction, B-U-T, is a miracle conjunction. That word but literally disqualifies everything that preceded the word but. He said, Lord, I can't hear you. Lord, you've been silent. Many of the affliction of the right.
whole tone of the conflict. How do you handle the silence of God? The first thing you must do is never begin to think that God's hand has been removed from your life.